This is G Darkness from the Avenged Escape Plan, Dillinger style. And you're listening to Metal Injection on internet website radio.com land.
Rob here with Greg, the Dillinger Escape Plan vocalist. Hello. And you guys just put out Ironworks.
We did.
First question, why doesn't it sound exactly like Calculating Infinity?
You know what, man? Like, we actually wanted it to sound exactly like Calculating Infinity. We actually wrote the same exact songs and handed them in to our record label, and they said no, that they wouldn't put it out.
Don't they realize that's the only one?
Yeah. We figured what better way to write Calculating Infinity Part 2 than to actually write Calculating Infinity again?
Yeah.
But they wouldn't go for it. We figured we would just change the artwork, put it out as Ironworks.
Yeah.
Maybe. And then we thought maybe we would actually write the songs backwards. Like, if we would write, like, this time
34%
it would be like 34% burn, and it would start with a long breakdown, and then it would end with the, you know, other part that no one cares about, you know.
Why didn't you just do that? That just sounds so much cooler.
Then we had a horrible idea that we would actually write 13 new songs that didn't sound anything like Calculating Infinity, which, you know, bummed a lot of people out. But
I mean, okay, I kind of liked it. I mean, I'm not gonna lie, it was good.
Yeah,
there were some songs.
Okay, you know, it's not, you know, it's not the greatest.
There's no 43% burnt on there. That's for sure.
No, there's a severe lack of chug chug wee wee.
So I think one thing about Ironworks that, I mean, I've recognized and I've read in a bunch of places, a bunch of other people saying, is I think the mellower songs stand out more than like the traditional Dillinger songs. When you guys,
Which is really weird to me because obviously like that's not what we started out doing.
Yeah.
And I also don't think it's because there's only like one of them. It's not like there's an album full of like crazy songs and then there's like one other song. So to me, like, you know, I hope it doesn't mean that we're getting worse at writing like the crazier, faster songs, because I think they're just as good as like anything off of Calculating. But, you know, it's nice that maybe it's just people are used to that from us now, and it's like exciting to them that we can actually do something else and pull it off well instead of just like, you know, attempting to do it and not really nailing it. Not saying that's what we did on Miss Machine, but I definitely feel like the extra ingredients on this record are way more, like, fully developed than they were on Miss Machine. So I feel way better about, like, Milk Lizard than I felt about Setting Fire, and way better about Black Bubblegum than I felt about Retrified. So that's, you know, a good thing.
Yeah, and I mean, you and Liam drove cross-country.
I remember still over there. I refused to drive back. Like,
and you guys try to do it in as quick a time as possible.
Have you ever heard of Cannonball Run? Like, you know, like, but you know that there is actually a real record, right? Like a real like Cannonball Run, like east to west coast, like land speed record. The official time is like 34 or 35 hours, and we figured we would just fucking go for it, you know? And so we took off at like 7 p.m. on Wednesday night. And we ended up getting to California in the middle of the night, Friday night to Saturday morning. So it actually ended up taking us like 48 hours or something. So we didn't even come close. But which I don't understand, because we were literally going over 100 miles an hour for at least half of the time. You know what I mean? I got like $400 worth of speeding tickets. Like, you know, we didn't sleep the whole time. My first shift of driving, I drove for 22 hours, only stopping to piss and eat. And then Liam took over for like 8. And then I finished. Like, we didn't stop to sleep. We just got to California, like totally fucked up. Like, we couldn't find the hotel. The worst was like the last 10 minutes, because we were in the town that we were supposed to get to, and we didn't know the name of the hotel. And we're just calling everyone, and everyone's asleep. And we're just like, if we don't fucking get to a bed soon, I'm gonna freak the fuck out. And whoever's in the bed when we get to the hotel is getting up. You know what I mean? And letting us sleep, because they've just been chilling here. Ben flew. You know what I mean? Like, he was too much of a pussy to drive out. Because it's Ben Weinman, you know what I mean, the Svengali of the Dillinger Escape Plan. So he took a jet to the West Coast and hung out and like went to some like red carpet premiere of some movie and took pictures with him and Brad Pitt while we're just, you know, manning it across the country, you know. And so, you know, we got there and it was cool, you know. I now have a warrant for my arrest in like 3 different states for not paying those tickets, and my car is still in California because it took so much out of us to do that there was no way in hell I would ever do it again. Like, I would rather sell my car there and then eventually buy another one here than ever do that drive again, you know. The worst thing ever. So
it mattered.
It's one of those things where when you look back on it, you're like, that was fucking awesome. but I don't ever want to do it again.
What was like the weirdest thing you saw on the road? Like, there must have been some weird things in like the Midwest.
The weirdest thing we saw on the road happened to be in the Midwest. Like, we took a shit ton of mushrooms and went to the Grand Canyon, and we're pretty much just like, we were like, we're gonna take as much mushrooms as possible to fucking like, just get. I mean, it looked like the Grand Canyon was like fucking coming out of the ground. You know what I mean? Like, it's, like, it got to the point where we were like, you know, I don't know if you've ever fucking done it before. I'm sure you probably have. You know, like, we were,
I mean, no.
Okay. But we're on, don't ever do drugs, kids. But we were like on, going out onto like pedestals that were like jetting out into the middle of the Grand Canyon and like standing on the edge of it and like standing like the Karate Kid on like the edge of things that if I would have fallen off of that, I would have died. You know what I mean? But right. Like, I didn't even comprehend that because of how whacked out of my mind I was that, I was standing on 1 foot on a gravelly surface 5,000 feet in the air. You know what I mean? Like, I would have... I have a fear of heights. If I would not have been high, I would have been on my belly, like, trying to crawl to the edge. You know what I mean? And instead, we were like, look, we're doing pull-ups off, pull-ups off the edge of the canyon. You know? That was awesome because it was, we were almost there. Like, we were, like, 6 or 7 hours away from being there.
It actually took you 3 weeks, but because of the shroom high.
Like 2 hours, yeah. It was actually a month. But we were mushrooms, so, you know. But, that was cool. And, you know, there was a lot of weird things. Like, I got pulled over in Texas, and they made me get out and get in the cop car, which I've never had to do for a traffic violation before. And I was totally freaked out by it. It's Texas, you know, and they kill people for lesser things than speeding out there, you know. So I was going literally like 115 miles an hour. Like, it was like 3 a.m. I didn't even see the cop, you know. And we were just listening to like fucking Justice for All, like Dimed, you know what I mean? Just like blazing, ripping through the desert. And, you know, we see the lights and I pull over and I'm certain that I'm going to jail. You know what I mean? I'm like, there's no way you're getting pulled over in Texas going 115 and not getting, you know. So the first thing he does is, you know, get out of the car. And I'm just like, oh, fuck. You know what I mean? And he's like, come get in my car. And I was just like, all right, Liam, like, if I leave, like, call someone. Like, I don't know what's going to happen. I'm going to end up in like some old West bar. I don't even know what jails look like in Texas, but I assume that they look like they did in the old West, where it's like a cabin with one cell in it and you're just in it, you know, like the cartoons. But he just sat me in the car, talked to me for like a half an hour about the perils of barreling down the highway in Texas, about how he could take me to jail, and then started being cool and talking to me about like rock and roll and like singing in a band and how he used to be in a band. I was like, I'm getting a break here. This dude's like actually somewhat cool. He's gonna tell me, we're talking about like, I was trying to be like, yeah, Van Halen, Aerosmith, like anything I could do to get this guy's attention. And then he gave me like a fucking $200 ticket. So it was like, thanks a lot for like being super cool to me and, you know, talking to me about music, and then slapped me with a huge fine. But whatever, you know, I don't know. It was a good drive, man. The combination of being completely sleep deprived, on drugs, and you know, hurtling through time and space at 100 miles an hour made for a good trip.
Sounds like a fun experience to do right before you record.
Recommend it to anyone that was going to record.
Cross country first.
Even
and
if
then
you don't have to. Even if you're recording 10 minutes away from your house, I recommend that you drive to the middle of the country and back. Do drugs at like the midway point. And then drive back as fast as you can. And then when you come back, you're just going to be ready.
Did you guys do any driving on shrooms? Any of that? Or you're being responsible?
No, we sat still at the Grand Canyon until we finished. And then the thing that sucked the most is that we didn't realize that there's no lights at the Grand Canyon. There's no such thing as a street light at the Grand Canyon. So we're just like wandering around the high of our mind. Then the high wears off and we realize that it's pitch fucking black. Like literally hand in front of face, pitch black. We have absolutely no idea where the parking lot is because it's like half a mile away from the actual Grand Canyon. We are just at this big hole in the earth. So we start like yelling like at the top of our lungs, like, hello! Like, is there anybody near the parking lot? We're trying to get by. And then we hear like another voice in the distance, like a woman being like, we're trying to find the parking lot too. And it's like all the way on the other side. So we're like, we're both fucked. We're going to end up having to sit here all night until the sun comes up. We're both fucked. And then we ended up like from yelling, getting to the old women. And they were like 50 fucking years old and completely way higher than we were. So this is like pretty awesome. Like the second we got in the car and turned the headlights on, there was like this fucking 7-foot-tall moose like right in front of the car that we didn't even see when the headlights weren't on. Like we just turned on the lights and there was this giant animal. We're just like, fuck, like we're gonna get out of here. So it was a good time.
Now, you know, recently, a few months ago, Chris Penny left, and I mean, I'm not gonna bring up any questions because I've been reading a bunch of interviews and
fuck
pretty
you.
Much
I'm just joking. That's what people want. They always think, yeah, that guy fucking sucks, you know, fuck Coheed. That's what they want from me.
Cool. We're just totally going to edit it that you actually said it that way.
When I see the interview, there's that question's not going to say, it's just going to be, fuck Coheed, like on a loop over and over again. Like a big drama out of it.
Yeah, but sometimes, like, especially with some of the foreign interviews, I noticed, like, some of the questions could be a little awkward. Yeah, like, what is it like? Like, you guys had a huge, like, you know, personal thing, and then, like, to have it be open and, like, people asking, like, anything, it must have been a little awkward.
Well, yeah, their European questions are great because they are fucking right to the point, man. They don't fucking beat around the bush. If they think your album sucks, they tell you right away. Like, I did an interview with, like, Metal Maniacs Italy, and he was like, first of all, and, like, most of the time people were just, like, kiss your ass. I'm like, first of all, I'm going to say that I really like your album. He was like, first of all, Dillinger Escape Plan, not my favorite band. Ironworks, not so into. Just to let you know, it's just my, I got assigned this interview, and I was like, oh, I actually kind of dig that approach, man. Cool, thanks, because I fucking probably... I haven't read Metal Maniacs in like 20 years either, buddy, so good for you to write for some shit rag. But no, man, it's true. Like, the thing with Chris was a massive falling out, man. It happened over a super long period of time that a lot of people aren't aware of. It wasn't like, a lot of people were looking for like the easy thing. Like, Coheed and Cambria was like, they came along and fucked up our whole flow. You know what I mean? Which is not the case. Like, Coheed and Cambria was like the life raft that Chris jumped on. You know, he was looking for that. You know what I mean? But in the band, it had gotten to a point where, like, I can see the if I look back at it, I can see, like, the personal deterioration starting probably, I mean, years and years ago, like 5-6 years ago, but really starting to snowball right after Miss Machine came out. And a lot of things happened, like, you know, Brian, his hand fucked up, and then he wasn't around anymore. And Brian kind of had, like, he was the oldest person in the band. He kind of had, like, this elder role in the band where he would keep people in check a little bit. And Tom, our old manager, had went to school with Chris and had known Ben since they were in high school. And, like, Tom was the one person that would sit Ben down and be like, you know, you're being a fucking asshole. And sit Chris down and be like, you're being a fucking baby. You know, and when those two people were gone, you know, like, Chris and Ben just started fucking going at it all the time, you know. And it became very apparent that I was being put, like, in the middle of those two. You know what I mean? And if those two had to hang out together without me, like, I would know, because literally I could tell whether or not they practiced that night, because at 2 a.m. my phone would just be ringing and it would be both of them. And they would both be wanting to tell me about how much the other one pissed them off. You know what I mean? And I would have to sit there and mediate them, and it just became draining. I was literally spending, you know, by like the fall of 2006, spending like 2 hours of my day every day, like trying to keep them from fucking fighting, you know? And it just became a drain. And looking back on it, like someone had to go. You know, when we were on tour with AFI, Ben actually quit and went home for a few days because of some big fight he had with Chris. And we told everyone that it was like because of some personal dilemma. But the real truth is that he fucking had a major blowout with Chris. They told him to fuck off and he left. And that was like really like, you know, it was never right after that. It was interesting because we were writing really good shit. That was really confusing to all of us. And I think it was confusing to Chris and Ben too, is that like we were writing like the best stuff that I felt that we had ever written. But as people, like, we had never not gotten along so well. And like, I started to think that there was like, you know, this romanticism to not getting along. You know what I mean? That like, oh, we're a train wreck, you know, the reason why we write such chaotic music is because we fucking can't stand one another. And you start to actually believe that hype a little bit, that you need to be in an unhealthy relationship to have like good creativity come from it. Totally. I don't know if I can't say it's not true, because obviously I really like this record and most of the record came out of turmoil, but I don't believe it's necessary to fucking be in an unhealthy relationship to have a productive, creative one.
It's also a little restricting because you got to figure like, oh, what is that person going to think of like what I'm doing?
Man, there was time. I mean, it was so uncomfortable to be in the room with just those two that it was like, I would feel weird about leaving the room and letting them two be together, because you never knew. It was so incendiary that they could go from talking to screaming. Like, I've never seen adults scream at one another like that in like 30 seconds, you know, over nothing, over a part in a song that would just trigger so much old shit that would boil to the surface, you know? So, I mean, something had to go, and it wasn't going to be Ben Wyman, because he writes all the fucking songs, you know what I mean? Like, he's the guy who, like, you know, from the beginning of time has been the constant in this band. You know, he writes all the music, and I think that's something that a lot of people didn't realize, is that Chris really wasn't that big of a writer, you know what I mean? He pretty much was Ben's tool for, you know, he was like, Ben's like, I need a guy who's super fucking good to play this shit. And that was Chris, you know what I mean? And the second Chris was gone, you know, we all thought we were up Schitt's Creek because we thought we were never going to find another guy that was that good. We contacted like people who we thought were the cream of the crop, like Dave Witte and Ken Schalk and people who, you know, Terry Bozzio, people who were just like, this guy's the best. And they were all just like turning it down because of time commitments or because they were just like, look, I can't play this shit, you know? And so when we found Gil and saw that he could actually play it, we were, you know, relieved. But then we were, you know, also worried, like, can we actually write with this guy? And we wrote, like, ended up writing, like, 30% of the record with him, and it was such a fucking relief, you know? So everything worked out for the better, man. And looking back on it, I wish that we would have cut the Chris situation so long ago. You know what I mean? And we were scared. We felt like we were held hostage because of his talent, because we just didn't know that there was this other guy lurking out there that was, you know... At this time, in 2007, Gil Sharon is a way better fit musically and personality-wise than Chris was. But it's like when you're in a bad relationship, man, and the people outside of it are telling you that you're in a bad relationship and you're just holding on because it's all you've known for a while, you know? Yeah. And then when you step outside of it and look back at it, you're like, why the fuck didn't I get out of that a year ago? You know? And that's kind of how it went. But I wish Chris all the luck in the world. You know, like I said, it's real easy for people to be like thinking that we're going to be like, fuck Coheed and Cambria, you know? And I don't care at all about that band, good or bad, you know? Means nothing to me. I hope that he's successful because he's extremely talented, you know, so.
Cool. And just one last question. When can we expect a Dillinger Escape Plan Avenged Sevenfold tour?
Soon, man. Apparently, our tour manager, Chris Holland, is friends with Matt Sanders, otherwise known as...
Is that M. Shadow?
M. Shadows, yeah. And I don't know, man.
It should happen, man.
It's like Metallica, Guns N' Roses, except... Only one of the bands are talented.
It would be like Metallica Poison, dude. Let's not get it twisted here. No, I'm just joking. I don't want
you guys being Poison.
Us probably being Warrant. We would be like the opening band. There would have to be another band that would be Poison and Metallica, and us would be Warrant. No, but no, seriously, I'm not opposed to that at all, man. Like, that drama is old. I've never, you know, I don't really have that much of a fucking beef with that guy. I don't care, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like, it's just fun to stir up shit and watch people react to it. You just, know?
Yeah, commenters.
Yeah, you know, like, and the thing about him is that, like, he just fed it more, you know what I mean, by his reaction to what I was saying, you know. Like, if I say something somewhat benign and your reaction is to call me a faggot, like, then you just pretty much opened up a giant, you will not win. You will not win a game of, like, shit talking against me. Will not happen, you know what I mean? So, like, And he pretty much lost as soon as his most intelligent response was, those guys are faggots. You know what I mean? So I was like, all right, you just pretty much dug your own hole. But at this point, I would tour with him in a heartbeat, man. Fuck it, let's do it, you know? It'll be a good time, you know? It'll, you know... Obviously, we're only about a 25th as big as they are, so it wouldn't be as big of a deal to most people as it would be to us. But I'm waiting for your call, man. Let's do it.